I went to high school in Georgia, and when I was there, I had a social studies teacher who had a picture of Martin Luther King and another fellow on his wall. I didn't know who the other fellow was. And when I asked, I said, I know who Martin Luther King is, but I don't know who that is. And he said, that's Malcolm. He gave me a copy of the autobiography of Malcolm X to read, knowing that I read quickly and habitually. And when I was done, it really changed my life. I had my first sense of what it was like to not be white in America. In the 90s, I went to see Spike Lee's movie, Malcolm X, in Los Angeles. And when I did, I was the only white person in the theater. Honestly, I don't know if I was the only white person in the theater, but it really felt like it. And watching the movie screen filled with people who did not look like me, telling stories that were foreign to my experience, surrounded by people who did not look like me, it showed me that I thought I knew what it was like to not be white in America. But at that moment, I knew what it was like to be in a building full of people who did not look like me, watching a movie with people who did not look like me. I was the outsider. And since I came into the game industry, I've tried to expand representation in the game industry with my games. I have had various success. My game Orcworld is about taking the stereotypical evil fodder of Dungeons and Dragons, which is orcs, and turning them into a real culture with different values and different experiences. And I felt comfortable doing that with orcs because they're make-believe. Now in 7th C, I'm working with a fellow named Derek Pounds on a book called Land of a Thousand Nations, which is about bringing the Native American First Nations into the world of 7th C. It's been an incredible experience learning about a new culture, learning about its values and its taboos, its language, its stories. Meanwhile, Derek was working on another game, and we're going to be making a character for that game today. That game is Coyote and Crow. Now, this is the PDF, because I don't have the book yet, but I did back the Kickstarter. Coyote and Crow has an alternative history where certain events caused things to happen differently so that the Europeans didn't make it over to the North American shores and the First Nations prospered. In much the same way that Black Panther is Afrofuturism, Coyote and Crow is Native American futurism. Also, it goes into detail on how this world is different than our world. Certain technology never got developed. For instance, the car never got developed. One of the things I have a problem with, by the way, Coyote and Crow people, is no fry bread. Out here in Phoenix, we have an incredible restaurant run by First Nations peoples, and it's the Fry Bread House, and it is amazing. However, I am willing to sacrifice fry bread for the world of Coyote and Crow. I would, in a heartbeat, yes, I will totally do that. How does the game system work? It's you roll a bunch of D12s. It's called the D12 system, and you're looking for target numbers, usually an 8 or higher, although the GM can, and the players can raise or lower that number. You count the number of dice that equal 8 or higher, and you get successes, and there you go. You're off to the races. For me, when I was developing games like Legend of the Five Rings and 7th C, it was very important for me to portray other people's cultures with as much dignity and respect as I wanted my culture to be portrayed. And so when we did nations like Montaigne and Avalon and Eisen and the Sarmatian Commonwealth, especially the Sarmatian Commonwealth, hi Polish people, I wanted people from those cultures to feel like we got it right. I often have the image of my grandfather's Irish ghost hanging over my shoulder, just waiting for me to make a mistake. Coyote and Crow does that too. Not only that, they do a really good job of explaining the nuances of First Nations cultures. I've learned a lot working with Derek on the Land of a Thousand Nations book, and I see all the stuff that he told me about and warned me about in this book. I could do a whole hour of things, of nuances and things, but I'm not going to do that. I'm going to encourage you to use the doobly-doo below, get the book, and learn about it yourself. As for my character, once again, I rolled randomly for gender. This time I got male. And my character has 9 stats, which are strength, agility, and endurance, intelligence, perception, and wisdom, spirit, charisma, and will. And it has a point buy system where you have a number of points, and when you buy up your attributes, they cost more points. So a 2 only costs 6 points, but a 4 costs a lot more. And these represent the number of dice you're going to be rolling to try to roll 8 or higher. So when I roll an agility test, I'm actually going to be rolling 5 dice. I got 4 plus 1 for my archetype. And trying to see if one of them rolls an 8 or higher. There's also skills. Skills use the same kind of system. And your character also has abilities, which are unique things that you get to do. One of the things I really like is the idea of gifts and burdens. And gifts and burdens are like advantages and disadvantages, in that they give you more points or they cost points. But they're all personalized. You'll see what I mean when we get to my character. So my character's name is Wasakan. I think that's the correct pronunciation. Also, there is a utility on their website for making character names. That's what I did. I went there and I made a character name, and I got Wasikan. I believe, like I said, that's pronounced Wasikan, but somebody please correct me in the comments if I'm wrong. My archetype is warrior. I decided not to go the cliche of thief. You're welcome, Jared. And I'm on the path of the coyote. I rolled randomly for that. I rolled 3d10 and I went down the top of the list a number of times. And I'm very happy with Coyote. He is one of my favorite characters in Native American stories. He's right up there with Rabbit. And my character's motivation is family. You have a motivation that gives you bonuses when you roll for risks that involve your motivation. And my gift is my sister. I'm a warrior and on the path of Coyote. My sister, however, is a seeker. She's also blind. Seekers look for mysteries and uncover hidden things. So she may be blind, but she sees a lot. And because of that, I am bound to protect my sister because she has a little bit of a problem protecting herself. So I get to play the bodyguard. And I am 100% okay with that. As for skills, I have a 3 athletics, a 1 ceremony, 1 knowledge, 1 language, 3 melee weapons, 2 ranged weapons, a 2 stealth, a 2 survival, a 2 tracking, and a 3 unarmed combat. Yeah, I'm the fighter. My abilities include Hawk's Eye, which allows me to see things further than I should normally be able to see them. Oh, and by the way, when I mentioned burdens and gifts, my sister is a gift and a burden. The book said I could do it. I'm doing it. I also want to mention the art really quick. I was really impressed with the art in this book. The cover is a lot of fun. You get pieces like this, and you get pieces like this. Stunning, stunning artwork. Well done. And that's my character for December 27th, 2021. You should go and check out Coyote and Crow. It does a really, really great job of showing you a culture that you probably have never seen before, and if you're living in the United States, is right here, right with us. I want more people playing role-playing games, and the more that people see themselves in role-playing games, the more gamers we will get. That's why representation is important. I want to celebrate this literary genre of ours and share it with everybody. And I am super excited that the Coyote and Crow people have made a role-playing game with their people in it. Kudos. So until tomorrow, wear a mask, get the shot, take care of each other, and most importantly, go find someone who doesn't look like you and get them into gaming. Because the more voices we have, the stronger the chorus becomes.